session is going to talk about Chinese strategy and role in Myanmar. And in order to address this issue, we have with us three very distinguished speakers. I'm going to call upon the first of the speakers, Kim Aung So, to talk about Chinese strategy and the role of China in Myanmar. Just a brief introduction about the speaker. He is a person with obviously multiple discipline knowledge, which is a kind of rare combination of a management degree, an agricultural sciences degree, and a diploma in political science. And he's got lots of experiences in all kinds of jobs, including farmer, working in international hotels, working in the newspapers, and is obviously a person with a wide range of experience. And he's also a national consultant for the Asian Development Bank project in Mandalay. Without any further delay, let me call upon Mr. So to make his presentation. Thank you very much.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for the opportunity given. My topic is Chinese role, investment, and aid in Myanmar. Here are the outline for my presentation. I would like to start my presentation by giving you a brief explanation on Myanmar, which is well known for its natural resources. The Myanmar is blessed with all different kinds of the natural resources, the gemstone, the gold and gas and oil and many minerals. The Myanmar jade and the ruby are highly appreciated everywhere. Even in India, Myanmar ruby is highly appreciated. You have very famous movie, Three Idiots. In that the movie, they say the ruby from Mandalay, that ruby is highly appreciated. The many experts say that Myanmar is poised to become a new economic frontier because of the many factors. In fact, Myanmar has a glorious past and promising futures. As you have been aware, the fact that since 2011, the country has been experiencing a series of significant political and economic transformation. In theory, Myanmar is to become a new economic frontier of the Asia. The Rockefeller Foundation in the United States has predicted in their 100 Resilient project that Manly will definitely become a new economic frontier in Asia. Manly is the cultural city of Myanmar. The Manly was founded in 1859. Manly is strategically located between the India and China. I think you might have known about the 100 Resilient City project initiated by the Rockefeller Foundation in United States of America. The Manly has been awarded, selected one of the 100 Resilient City project because of its increasing geopolitical significance. Bangalore has been selected one of the 100 resilient city, along with other two cities in India, Chennai and the Surat. There are many challenges in transforming Myanmar into a truly constitutional democracy. Although we have a lot of high expectation from the international community because of the India rise and China rise, because of many positive development in ASEAN. The yes, of course, all the challenges has its own opportunity and the dangers. I believe Myanmar will be able to overcome all the challenges and then obstacle with the help of the good neighbor like the India and Thailand, Japan. I believe because in 2012 I visited here. I had a chance to attend IIMB Bangalore management course, and I met Indian entrepreneurs, Miss Karen Mazanders, who is the founder of the Biocon. She said, and I quote, Burmese and the Indian have more or less same DNA. If Indian can, why not Myanmar? I believe that. The international community is like the India. They are cautiously optimistic about the ongoing change in Myanmar. Before I came here on 13 and 14 July, I had a chance to attend a workshop in Mandalay organized by the Community of the Democracy, founded by the former U.S. Secretary of State, Madeleine Albright. And then during this workshop, two-day workshop, I had a chance to interact with many the scholars. Especially, I had a chance to talk with one the police the political expert who specialized in transitional justice. He is very optimistic about the Myanmar change. Also, she told me that Myanmar has a lot of advantages, especially the Mandalay city, because as I just right now, it is situated between the China and India. And also, after Myanmar becoming a ASEAN member, Myanmar have achieved some the milestone, especially 2013, Myanmar successfully hosted the 27th SEA Games, and 2014, Myanmar hosted the 25th ASEAN Championship, and now 2015, Myanmar has to integrate into the ASEAN, the economic community. One has come to the talking about democracy. Many scholars define democracy in many different ways. But my favorite definition of the democracy is democracy is a process in which all of us the aspire for constant development by sharing and learning. Today, the conference here is the fitting example of the definition of that democracy. We come here and we share thought, view, and we learn each other. I am very thankful to the Institute who have taken a lot of initiative for making this a very good conference. Let me elaborate on why Myanmar is the important for the neighboring country like China and the India. This the slide show you the same important the statistic about the Myanmar and China, India, and the Myanmar next door neighbor, the Bangladesh, the Thailand, Laos. The total population of this region is 2.9 billion people. This is 39.48% of the world population. These are the questions we should consider when we talk about the geopolitical significance. Regarding Myanmar political process, the general election will be held on November 8th. This is the very important the test of time for the U Thein Sein government. They said the election will be held in free and fair manners. And also, a lot of the unprecedented changes are taking place in relation to the election. Yesterday morning, I got information from Manly, the rector of the University of Yangon, where contacts the election by representing the NLD, and also 88 generation student, many the student leader will run in the election. These are the indication that the Myanmar democratization process had a lot of the positive outcome. For the sake of time, I'm not going to elaborate on how important it is for Myanmar. This picture show how important Myanmar is in terms of the geopolitical significance and the development of the regions. These are the informed process initiated by the President U Thein Sein. Myanmar is also very important because Myanmar is a member of many regional associations, including GMS, BIMSTEC, the ASEAN. This slide show the detailed layout of the China oil and gas pipeline. The Dawei Seaport is a very important project in Myanmar because this will change the sea route. Before I talk about my main topic, China investment, I would like to share this important statistic with all of you. This is very recent figure by the Ministry of Finance. This is the foreign investment of the permitted enterprise as of 13 June 2015. The oil and gas is at the top of the foreign direct investment, and China has been investing heavily in Myanmar, and there are as many as 100 permitted enterprises, and they have already invested a lot. Total, the 26% of all the foreign direct investment. Let me start talking about my main presentation. The picture show how Myanmar is being under the Chinese influence. Their investment are everywhere. According to a report, the Chinese government invested in many sectors, especially hydropower, oil and gas, and mining. These are the list of the company, Chinese company, who have been working in Myanmar and different part of the country. This is the list. This is a oil and natural gas company invested heavily in the Myanmar. This is a mining sector. Shunan machinery equipment import and export, number 10, has been playing major role in facilitating the Chinese company, the business operation in Myanmar. As I said to you earlier, how important it is to build a friendly relationship between Myanmar and the India. This is the wisdom of your first prime minister. We are to maintain peace. We are to share the good luck and bad luck. I would like to quote George Modesky. He is a professor with the International Relations University of Washington. Regarding why India is important for Myanmar. Why the world power constructing and animating the global political system and successfully responding to a priority global problem, having sea power of global reach with open society and lead economies. The challenges that rose to oppose then were regional power with substantial land armies and less open society and economy. My interpretation is that China is the growing economically, the politically. China is very ambitious. For peaceful the growth, we are okay. But I'm sorry to say that in last April, I had a chance to visit the many China city, including the Macau and China. That trip was organized by the China Embassy in Yangon, and to mark the 65th founding diplomatic relationship between China and India. When we were in the Guangzhou, we had many the discussion with the Chinese people, especially from the government representative and the university political professor. I'm sorry to say, they even want to force us why your government decided to stop the Misong Dam in Kachin State, because that project will benefit your country and also China. Even China has experienced a lot of the bad consequences for building dam, but economy is more important than the environment. But our understanding that the economic growth is important, but every country has to strike a good balance, what is good for the economy and what is good for others. And also our delegation leader was not very happy with the discussion. And let me conclude my presentation by the SWOT analysis, that we have the serious discussion about Myanmar, the opportunity, the risk, weakness, and strengths. International community and many friendly country in the Asia has great expectation. Myanmar will become a new economic frontiers. But we have a lot of challenges, just I stated in here. Therefore, we need help from the good neighbors. We need understanding. We need we are to define the problem, especially Myanmar is facing today. And that we have the powerful neighbors. We agree that China is very powerful. It has a global power, but I am not very sure China has power to empower the next door neighbor like Myanmar. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. You have managed to precisely keep to the time, so thank you very much for. And thank you for a very informative presentation on what China is actually doing in Myanmar. I think that's very useful information, which we can certainly use in our when we conclude on the proceedings of whatever we're trying to do here. I invite the next speaker, Sayantani Sen Mazumdar.
Thank you, sir. Good afternoon, everybody. The title of my presentation is Neighborhood Impact on Myanmar's Changing Dynamics. My study is to is an attempt to appraise the relevance of the influences of two most significant neighbors of Myanmar, that is India and China, on its transition. As we know that India's Lucist policy or actist policy has given considerable momentum to Myanmar as a gateway to ASEAN, which in turn is conceived by India as a springboard to reach out to the wider Pacific region. So Myanmar straddling both South and Southeast Asia serves as a link between two regions. But People's Republic of China is also an important component of Lucist policy as it is strategically located and has tremendous political and economic influences in the region. So, both China and India's approach towards Myanmar should not be detrimental to each other, but we have to accept the fact that India is a bit apprehensive about China's dominance in the political and the economic domains of Myanmar. Now, post-2010, changing dynamics in Myanmar have imparted it a defined identity from a pariah state to a flourishing destination. And in the past couple of years, Myanmar has gained both strategic and political importance in international relations. So in its transition, the country is struggling hard to accommodate its past with its present, thereby trying to synthesize its enduring historical and cultural dynamics with the contemporary economic and geopolitical realities. And located between two Asian giants, India and China, Myanmar today wants to exploit its strategic and economic leverage for its own benefit without tagging around any one country. And following its entry into ASEAN in 1997 and recent process of reformation, it has emerged both as a challenge and an opportunity for both the Asian countries. So as we know, and a lot has been discussed on India's reformation from 90s onwards under Lucist policy, and these reforms led to a dramatic acceleration in India's economic growth, and at the same time, a need to balance against China's rising power, economic influence, has been an imperative in India's engagement with Myanmar. So in Myanmar's transition to democracy, more specifically from isolationist past towards modernized liberal state, the study of the influences or India's and China's relative proximities to this neighbor therefore assumes special significance for both academic as also policy studies. Very shortly, as Myanmar, the melting pot of neighborhood influences, we have to accept the fact that Myanmar's crucial geostrategic location and its commonality of borders with India and China offer it both boon and curse to be either a booming economic center or a strategic pawn. And we also know that Myanmar has disparate experiences of administrations, from domestic policies, from independence, range from civilian rule to a socialist military junta, a military-dominated socialist single-party mobilization system, to an authoritarian military regime, and in 2011, a disciplined flourishing democracy. So this varied administration have largely influenced its foreign policy, and especially Sino-Burmese relations to a great extent. And this have profound implications on the strategic concerns between India and between China and Myanmar. On the other hand, India's close cultural and spiritual ties with Myanmar pose threat to China's increasing dominance, and these close proximities in areas of soft power resources make Myanmar more integrally related to India, and India's attempt to rediscover Asia through the actist policy substantiates that. Now, Myanmar's utmost dependence on China was an offshoot of certain geopolitical considerations, but there prevailed certain oversimplified notions about the bilateral ties. As Myanmar is a client state of China, that Chinese influence is monolithic. China is so dominant that the current and future Burmese administration will be entirely dependent on its northern neighbor. Every move by the Chinese is part of a calculated plan to advance their power. Myanmar's democratization is entirely dependent on Chinese attitudes, and the US policy of regime change in Myanmar did not succeed because of Chinese support to the military junta. But I must say these are certain misinterpretations of the intricacies of the bilateral equations. Very shortly, the Sino-Myanmar cooperation is that, as we know, that the contemporary period is presaged by a historical set of relationships, and the comprehending of such is imperative for the analysis and formulation of contemporary policies. Untoward incidents like the military coup and the killings of the students in 1988 in Yangon, as well as the killings of the Chinese students in 1989 in Tiananmen crisis, evoke certain international criticism and Western economic sanctions. So the West's diplomatic isolation of Myanmar opened up new arenas of opportunities for Beijing to fill the strategic vacuum in Myanmar and forward collaboration with the neighbor. Moreover, the geographic location bears strategically important connotations for China, as it is the land bridge for the People's Liberation Army Navy in the long term to reach the Indian Ocean via the Myanmar-controlled Koko Islands, which are about 30 kilometers north of the Indian-controlled Andaman Islands. Moreover, Myanmar's importance lies in providing China achieve direct access to the Pacific and the Indian Oceans, as there is a report that China and Myanmar had interests in joint development of a deep water port at Kiaku, I might be wrong in pronouncing, on the Ramri Islands in Bay of Bengal. And also there is alleged military installation at the Jaditki Island on Myanmar's southern tip of its territory, close to Indonesia's Sabang Island. It raised considerable skepticism about China's future maritime ambitions in the Indian Ocean. So China's foreign policy pursuits with Myanmar emphasize certain significant paradigm as ensuring a stable external environment with this resourceful neighbor, which would foster China's democratic modernization and development process. And China considered Myanmar as a gateway to restore its Southwest Silk Road from Yunnan province to Myanmar and westward to Bangladesh, India, and the West. And the development of this connectivity would accelerate the bilateral trade by promoting the backward economies in the southwestern part of inland China. The motive is to diminish the magnitude of economic disparities between the China's affluent coastal and its poverty-stricken southwestern inland provinces. And we know that Yunnan's energy requirement is a prime consideration of its perceived economic needs, which are driving force behind its strategic moves towards Myanmar. In China-Myanmar relation, Malacca dilemma plays a very important role. China is heavily dependent on foreign oil, and approximately 80% of these oil imports currently pass through the Straits of Malacca near Singapore, one of the busiest shipping lanes in the world. For Chinese strategies, the straits are a natural choke point through which future enemies could cut off foreign energy supplies. So an alternative route needs to be found, and Burma is the key. The work which has already begun on oil and gas pipeline will start to transport Burma's newly found offshore gas to China's Yunnan province. And also it is a strategic hedge against the Straits of Malacca, one that may bring Chinese political influence right up to the Indian Ocean for the first time in history. Now, China and Myanmar have made a considerable headway in the infrastructure projects. These are some of the projects. And moreover, in the 2008, the Prosper the Borders to Enrich Local People was, in combination with the construction of defense highway, solved the transport bottleneck coveting the frontier development. So in terms of transportation, Myanmar is an important avenue for Yunnan to have access to South Asia and to the Indian Ocean. In terms of resources, Myanmar is rich in oil, gas, timber, and gemstone. In terms of border security, the initiatives like countering narcotic trafficking, money laundering, and smuggling of arms are parameters of cooperation for both the countries. Now, very shortly, India's Myanmar engagement. As my previous speaker, sir, has already mentioned the famous statement by Prime Minister Nehru during Myanmar's independence. But as I'm repeating that as in the past, so in the future, the people of India will stand shoulder to shoulder with the people of Burma. And whether we have to share good fortune or ill fortune, we shall share it together. But with the coastline wide open on the Andaman Sea and the Bay of Bengal, facing the Indian territories of the Andamans and Nicobar Islands, Myanmar poses a strategic challenge to New Delhi. The surrounding areas of the Koko Islands and the Andaman Sea are decisive to India's strategic consideration. The overarching influence of China on Myanmar made India somewhat uncomfortable, particularly when China assisted to promote Myanmar's radar facilities in the Koko Islands and the construction of a naval base in Sitwe. But India is involved in a number of cross-border development projects with Myanmar in diverse fields like railways, roadways, connectivity projects to rejuvenate northeastern India and western Myanmar. And the trade points in the northeast border, such as Moray, Tamu, Zakfatar, Ikwadar, Avangkhuk, Somra, and Pangsu Pass, they need to be developed and operative for the essence of economic cooperation. So we can say India's plan to draw on its historic links and develop its common border with Myanmar is to reduce the underdevelopment of the northeast region. So it can be... And with this, the control of cross-border insurgency and cross-border drug trafficking constitute important dimension in the bilateral relations between New Delhi and Yangon. And both these countries have signed a number of treaties for controlling the insurgencies. So Indian interest in Myanmar can be summarized by the following considerations: containment of Chinese economic and strategic influences in Southeast Asia and Myanmar, guiding Myanmar in exploring its vibrant gas fields and thereby exploiting the energy resources, getting the Myanmar government to come down heavily on the northeast insurgents and rebel groups, and to obtain intermodal transit facility for the goods and services being traded between India and Southeast Asian countries. And from 2011 onwards, the exchange of bilateral visits and the last year in 2012, the Indian Prime Minister's statement in India-ASEAN Summit at Naypyidaw has heightened the bilateral ties to a great extent. Now a quick look at the India vis-a-vis Chinese influence in Myanmar. We have to say Myanmar's strategic importance witnesses the races between two neighbors vying for supremacy. Energy is the key resource for any country to grow and prosper. Myanmar is the repository of this asset, and it uses its strategic leverage to gain economic growth to sustain its political system. Myanmar appears to be rebalancing its ties with China, and this rebalancing was vividly demonstrated in the suspension of the China-funded Mitsun Dam project. As Sir was mentioning, it's an important dam of the most important river Irrawaddy, which is considered to be Myanmar's lifeline. With a reservoir the size of the state of Singapore, it has the capacity to flood a sizable Kachin population in an area that is regarded as a site of cultural importance. So protests have occurred, some bombings have taken place in the vicinity of the construction, and in 2011, President had to decide to suspend the project because it was against the will of the people. So this is an unprecedented concession of popular's opinion, which was unknown in half a century of military rule. So whether the scenario of other projects having impact on environmental degradation will have implications on other projects is a very important issue to ponder over. Moreover, certain impediments like border instability, growing resentment against Chinese dominance, unstable Myanmar governance, and growing international pressure might constrain China's goal of exerting supremacy in Myanmar. So we can say that while Myanmar accommodates China's regional strategic interests, it resists China's influence in Myanmar's internal affairs whenever necessary. So we can say that recent media reports communicate interests of many countries in exploring the potential areas of collaboration with Myanmar. And at this critical juncture, India's cooperation is vital to Myanmar's reform projects in a wide range of areas. From an Indian perspective, Myanmar is an open door to South Asia and Southeast Asia. And from a Chinese perspective, Myanmar presents an untapped market, alternative routes for natural resources, and stronger influence in the region. So it can be concluded that Myanmar has witnessed marked changes in its domestic policies and as well as in foreign policies, reforming the electoral system, releasing the political prisoners, encouraging media freedom, expanding civil society groups, establishing a national human rights commission, and a peace-building institute are the hallmarks of new Myanmar, which to some extent have bewildered the international community. But there are a number of challenges lying ahead. as leaders' ability to adapt to the new political challenges, challenges to economic development and the reconciliation process that is threatened by the Kachin problem, continuous religious conflicts as well as domestic democratic reforms, which have opened the road for expansion of trade and investment. So in this complex context, taking cognizance of Myanmar's resource riches and international dynamics, countries like the US, China, Japan have been enthusiastically outlining their strategic priorities and requirements in the country. So their extensive engagement should incite India to strengthen its age-old connections with Myanmar, and it would try to reorient the grand design of developing its northeast region, like China's Western development strategy for developing Yunnan into a world-class destination. For this purpose, development of border trade is required, and the knowledge and the command over English by the Northeast people can facilitate the pace of cooperation. So we can say that India must deepen its ties with this neighbor by soft power diplomacy and track two initiatives, and by utilizing such comparative advantages, it should rejuvenate interdependence and mutual benefits, contributing to peace and stability in Asia. So for activist policy, the priorities need to be acknowledged, framed, and concrete measures need to be implemented, which should be something different from being rhetoric. Thank you.
Thank you very much for a very succinct and very, what shall we say, very informative presentation. I now call upon Ramya to speak on facilitating ties and enhancing cooperation, the Yunnan factor in China-Myanmar relations.
Very good afternoon to everybody. My topic today is facilitating ties and enhancing cooperation, Yunnan factor in China-Myanmar relations. What I've tried to do is, unlike the previous speakers, I hope I won't repeat too much, but I'm going to stick to specifically China's relations with Myanmar over the years and looking at Yunnan as a specific case study. The format of the presentation is as follows. Taking a look at how external factors are impacting the center-periphery dynamics within Myanmar and situating China as such. Looking at a timeline of China-Myanmar relations, I won't dwell into this too much since it's still quite a bit of history, but I will look at the historical ties between Yunnan and Myanmar, as it is my case study. Look at the geography of the entire region. I keep coming back to geography because I think it's absolutely essential for my discussions that we've had over the 2 days on how policy is influenced by your geographic space. Then look at Yunnan's development and Myanmar, how the two feature. Look at the ethnic armed groups and the challenges that China is facing in general in its relations with Myanmar. How is China dealing with the center-periphery conflict in Myanmar? And a couple of observations. So external factors impacting the center-periphery dynamics. Till now, the conference has been focusing on the Burmese identity, the mainland, the Tatmadaw, the ruling elite. On top of this, we've superimposed ethnic groups where the center-periphery dynamic continues. You have Kachin, I've just listed out a few. And then now we're talking about external factors, such as China. You have the Chinese diaspora that has been in Myanmar over centuries. New age Chinese entrepreneurs who are making their way into Myanmar. And then you have the Chinese government that's formulating its policy. All of these are dictated by three specific indicators: geography, history, and politics. I'll try and deal with each of these in specific. I hope that this model runs throughout the entire presentation and it's clear. So looking at the timeline of China-Myanmar relations, I won't dwell too much into the 17th century to 1947, 1948 to 1962. I've only taken up specific important landmarks. For instance, in 17th century, there was partial suzerainty over Upper Burma by China. Border agreement, it was called a vassal state. Myanmar was called a vassal state. China claimed the town of Bhamo, a Kachin-dominated area, which gave access to ports along the Ayar Wadi, while the British sought to make Bhamo a free port area. The setting of a delineation committee was done in 1886, and in 1894, a treaty was signed to give effect to the previous convention. It is significant to note that as part of the border agreement, the British agreed to send delineal commissions to China, which has been cited by China as a claim that Myanmar was historically a part of its own territory. I think this is very significant to note because it shows you how geography and history come together in one country claiming land over the other. Although the border dispute is now resolved, there were certain claims that were made, and this is how the entire narrative was built. Between 48 to 62, broadly the relations between China and Myanmar were categorized as cautious but friendly. In 1952, the PLA attack happened because of the Kuomintang forces, which left a mark on the Tat Madaw as well. And then came the Pokpa phase, that is the cousins phase. From 62 to 88, the relationship was described because of Myanmar's own isolationism policy. There were anti-China protests, as everybody knows. And there was this report by a Chinese daily newspaper, Renmin Ribao, in 1980. And the article stated that this was the beginning of a golden bond of friendship between China and Myanmar. And this is when you actually started seeing changes in the relationship, given the Western sanctions and a lot of other factors that played into it. But the friendship was obviously not of equals. Between 88 to 2002, closer ties, increase in Chinese influence, counter-hedging strategy by China, which possibly led to the transformation that we're looking at right now. 2002 to present, there's been a perception of Myanmar being seen as a land bridge to the Indian Ocean for China. Looking at Yunnan, that's where Yunnan comes into the picture. Spillover of strategic interests, like the previous presenter very eloquently put it, of how all these factors come into play. And friendly relations have continued. Gray areas remain. History as a factor to the relations, there's been a lot of research done on the Sinization of Upper Burma, and this is where you see how Yunnan has kind of made an impact on the northern part of Myanmar. So historical ties between Yunnan and Myanmar, Shans, Kachins, and Chins of northern Burma are said to be from southwestern China, from Yunnan province. Despite cultural, racial, and even linguistic affinities between China and Myanmar, historically Myanmar remained exclusive to Manchu and Ming rule. This is going back to the partial suzerainty that I spoke about, looking at geography as an element. During the rule of Shan King Tarok Man Mingyi, the Chinese attempt to invade Myanmar was thwarted. There are several other occasions when small little kingdoms took control of either the Yunnan side or the Shan side. So there was a partial suzerainty there. Mongols and Ming dynasty established only partial suzerainty over Upper Burma. Historically, the Chinese kings controlled parts of the forests inhabited by the Shans, Kachins, and on other occasions, the Burmese Pa controlled Yunnan province, now which is part of China. This is a really old map that I found that talks about these pulkat regions from Yunnan. I thought it was interesting because you see that these relations didn't develop in a day, or Western sanctions, which is why China closed. And I think this gives a lot of perspective to see that these are historical ties and they will remain so. You have Yunnan there, Kunming right at the end, and these are all Maikinya, all of these, which we even today talk about pipelines going through and new projects. It's been historical, it's been there. So we look at geography now. Chinese diaspora and Sinization of Upper Burma. Like I said, it's not new. The Chinese presence in northern towns, however, is growing. Ethnic Chinese, about 3% of the total population. This is how they've been coming over the years and over the centuries. Legal Chinese immigrants, 300,000. Statistics vary. Illegal, as many as 2 million. Mandalay, nearly 30% of the population is Chinese. Lhasa, 50%. Again, the statistics could be grossly exaggerated in some cases and the others not. But this is the rough figure that I got. Most of the major rebel insurgent groups along the Myanmar-China border are the ethnic Shan and Wang. And a lot has been discussed about these. So this is just a perspective of where these regions are and how close they are to the Yunnan province, where you have a lot of Chinese presence, and that's the Wa state. I just put that out to see the new growing relations and the pipeline that's coming through. So Yunnan's development in Myanmar. The relation between the two nations through history has been built around trade, as neither side was decisively victorious over the other. This is looking at the historical precedents that I've given previously. The geoeconomic dimension of promoting China's development policy, especially of the landlocked Yunnan province, strengthened China's need to improve relations with Myanmar. Myanmar was seen as a land bridge for China to revive its southwest Silk Route by providing the southwestern provinces an outlet to the coast through Myanmar. Yunnan was designated a bridgehead for the country's integration with the Association of Southeast Asian Nations and South Asia. There's been heavy investment in road, rail, energy infrastructure, and a lot has been spoken about this in the past 2 days of the conference. And most of these reforms took place between 2000 and 2009. That's when the heightened approach occurred. And a lot of the ideas that we talk about in terms of the oil and gas pipelines all initiated from the Yunnan province. There was a provincial government that came into place where the central government allowed these periphery hinterlands to compete against each other and bridge their gaps with ASEAN. So if Yunnan had to develop, it did that on its own accord. It pushed its way through, made sure that the central government at Beijing heard them out, and that's how they pushed their entire policy upwards. Some quick facts. The ASEAN-China Free Trade Area, which came into force in January 2010, is a key element of the strategy that I'm going to talk about. There are 5 trade posts on the Myanmar side of the border with the Yunnan province, as listed. I will not try and pronounce them. And then you have infrastructure development, highway links, Mandalay, Lasho, Meuse Road. All these are very important because from historical times, yes, they've been there, but now you have tangible, easier access. Hydropower projects, again, oil and gas pipelines. What I'd like to point out with all of this is the idea of building the pipeline initially came from Yunnan local province in and as Yunnan clearly realized that there were enormous economic benefits to be gained if such a plan materialized. Yunnan adopted a variety of strategies to push for this initiative. Firstly, it effectively took advantage of the Malacca Strait dilemma. Some of the most influential media outlets and prominent scholars in China were mobilized to support Yunnan's plan. It also strongly lobbied various ministries in Beijing to gain their support. The Yunnan government's initiative coincided with the Chinese National Petroleum Corporation's plan to expand business in China, China's vast southwestern market, which has been seriously contended among oil giants within China. So this is how you see how Yunnan, in its sense, was essentially propagating its own policy, given the links. Also, you have Yunnan's role in ASEAN sub-regional cooperation, Yunnan-Myanmar Economic and Trade Cooperation Forum. This was provincially done, although it is part of the Chinese major... although China as a whole is seen to be part of the ASEAN network in trying to build ties, I would like to delineate the fact that Yunnan as a province pushed specifically for this policy. Cross-border trade between Yunnan and Myanmar. The first border trade agreement was signed in 1988 by Myanmar Export and Import Services and Yunnan Machine Import Export Corporation to use bank transactions between Myanmar Foreign Trade Bank and Kunming Bank of China. MIAS established the border trade offices in Lasho Meuse. Now you see that there's road development in these specific areas as well. Formal border trade agreement was signed in 1994. You also have a border control force that was put in place and use of local currency. However, problems still persist. And that being the ethnic armed groups along the China-Myanmar border. How is China dealing with the center-periphery conflict in Myanmar that we began with? We saw how a provincial government within China interacted with its close neighbors, pushed for a policy, development seems to be in place. You have these historical ties and baggage that comes with it and a geography that supports it. Beijing policy of non-interference in internal affairs was broken. This is what a large part of scholarly work has indicated, because Beijing tries to stay away from internal politics, quote-unquote. But Beijing has been trying to deal with these armed rebel groups independently. The role of the interlocutor, I think this comes through specifically in the Kachin case. 2013, China brokered deals with Kachin rebels. And there's an ethnic semblance with Kachin with the Kachin of Yunnan. What one needs to keep in mind at this stage is that Yunnan itself is a microcosm of a lot of ethnicities. So you have China that has to treat on a really narrow path in how it deals with these two factors. China gave airspace to Myanmar's air force to fight Kachin independent army. Informal arrangement, Kachin state depend on Yunnan province for subsistence. So you have these two approaches that are coming through. You have a Yunnan province that's pushing for its own development, and you have a central government that comes with its baggage of strategic interests. Where do you place these historical ties of Han Chinese, Kokang are Han Chinese, and the Wa army, again, is another story by itself. I think this map was already shown before. These are all the oil and gas projects in Myanmar. If you see the ethnic composition that I showed in the previous slides, are all again in the same region. You have Mandalay, Lasho. The development projects again in the same place is reinforced. And now you have again these new projects historically that have been there. So it's not that it's been a sudden upsurge from the 80s to now. What I'm trying to say is this narrative has continued for a long time. Development of Yunnan and hinterland, strengthening ties with the center, I think all these points have been covered. Other essential factors between China-Myanmar relations is the use of veto at the UNSC and easy loans that were given. So some observations. From whatever little I could understand, feel free to comment later. I think China has a dual approach in how it's dealing with Myanmar. You have a profit-driven provincial government, Yunnan. Pit that against the strategic planning of the central Chinese government. If it is faced with a problem like the Kachin rebel group, you have the central government that's pushing for one policy and the problems persist because you have Yunnan, a provincial government that's carrying out its own set of policies, because of which you have these illegal migration. I'm not saying this is the only reason, but it seems to be like a major driving force. China's facing problems of its own with the transition problems in place. The Mysore Dam, etc., all of these have been spurts of that. But I think these are other larger problems that need to be addressed as well. Strengthened relations with center coupled with tacit support for ethnic armed groups. This is where the two divergent approaches come into play. So China's view, do you support a stronger periphery? If you do, would you place your eggs around that basket? Concerns, refugee issues, of course, anti-China resentment. Has that actually begun? You have narcotic smuggling, all of these other facets to deal with. And Myanmar government on its own, from its behalf, would probably go for a hedging strategy, which is what it is adopting as of now. These are just some references. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, for, Ramya, for a very interesting and very different presentation. I must confess that I must compliment all the speakers. They stuck very strictly to the time. So we are now open for questions. We have about, when can we, how long do we have? Maybe we can take about 5-6 questions. So the floor is open for questions, please. Questions, please, yeah. Yes, sir, please.
We have been listening very carefully to our two lady speakers who seem to be so much concerned about Chinese influence in Myanmar. And also the way they see Myanmar from their standpoint. First, let's talk about the view on Myanmar. It looks to me they see Myanmar as just some sort of a gateway to the east, which is not good for Myanmar. If you are seeing just Myanmar as sort of a gateway without involving yourself in any way possible within Myanmar, that's not good. We want India, a friend for so many centuries, a country which we have looked up during our struggle for independence in the recent, you know, 3 or 4 centuries. 3 centuries, let's say. We thought India is our good friend and a great friend. But if your outlook is just to use Myanmar as a gateway, it's not good, okay? That's my first impression. The second point, it's not because you are worried about Myanmar's future. What you're worried is the expansion of Chinese influence. We've been dealing with Chinese for so many centuries. And we know at least about Chinese people more than India, because we happen to be more closer to China. Our story says that China and Myanmar are powerful, meaning brothers from the birth. And we like to understand each other in that way. And we keep on to identify each other in that way. If Chinese are, if Chinese have other ulterior motive, there are many chances for them to come and take Myanmar at their will. Especially, at least this is my personal view, okay? In 1988, when Myanmar was in a very distrustful disarray all over the country, they could have come into Myanmar and take the government very easily. Yet, they stay away from Myanmar. Also, when we say that we want to suspend Misson project for some or other reasons, of course they may not be happy with our decision, but yet they take it calmly. Of course, we know Chinese may have other interests in Myanmar, to use Myanmar as a gateway to Indian Ocean, to expand their market to the west through Myanmar. They may have a special policy towards Myanmar. That's as far as I can say. But they may not want to influence to the ultimate level. As you know very well, they have their own problem in their own homeland. They may not want to distract all their efforts from their involvement in Myanmar. So my observation of your presentation, first, you are unduly worried about Chinese influence. Second, you are seeing Myanmar as some sort of a gateway without bothering to do how you can do for us in Myanmar. Thank you.
Yeah, please.
If I understood the last interjection and if I understood the two papers properly, I think that is not what the ladies were implying, to use Myanmar as a gateway only. I think that sometimes even I say that that way, that Myanmar is a gateway, but the meaning is not that, that it is restricted to being a gateway. I think if Myanmar is a gateway, so is the northeast of India a gateway. So it has to be taken with a pinch of salt. Actually, the reason why such statements are made is perhaps because certain parts of this region are underdeveloped, and this gives an opportunity for their further development. And that is why we are focusing on those parts. But it is also an acknowledged fact that China is being feared by its neighbors because of its sudden rise. And the rise is in terms of the economy and in terms of its military. So though China speaks of a peaceful rise, there are facts to be confronted which speak for themselves about the rise of China in the region. And to that extent, those fears are sometimes expressed, which is not to say that cooperation is not possible. Certainly, wherever we can cooperate together, and we are cooperating, that cooperation will be there. But I think that misconception between India and Myanmar should not be there, that we are, you know, looking at it as a gateway, because there are various common interests which are there, and I think I'll stop
here. Led to some misunderstanding which is not correct. Now, having dealt years back with Burma and the region, let me give some of the thoughts which were there in the government in those days. The main point is China and India, of course, we are now trying to increase trade, solve problems between us. The fact of the matter is we have a problem. We have had problems in the past. It has started with the days when China supported the Burmese Communist Party to carry on depredations even in the Northeast. And it's also a fact that they have supported, not now anymore, supported in the past, many other rebel groups. So there is always, Burma has always been, Myanmar has always been a very, very important country for us strategically, apart from the cultural affinities, etc. And at least the present government has a very different take on its neighbors, and that is to develop together. And let's face a fact, if our neighbors are not strong, we are not going to, we go to live with the exploits, the countries being exploited by others. We don't want that. So what will, it's certainly, I don't think anybody in Delhi is thinking of Myanmar as a gateway at all. Yes, as he said, it's a very important aspect of trading. It is not just Myanmar, it's the whole route of increasing the trade and development, starting from India to Southeast Asia. And Myanmar just happens to be in the way. It doesn't mean they are the gateway. So Myanmar is important. Government of India will do everything possible to develop and give development aid, or see Myanmar comes up in its new developed country. But still, we all know that strategically also Myanmar is important because of our Northeast. Till the day, I'm sorry to say this here, till the day the entire Northeast feels one with India, till the day the Northeast rebels continue to harass India, and that's the only way, place where they can do it is from Myanmar border area. To some extent, a large extent, by some extent, we have been able to manage the situation with regard to Bangladesh, but not yet with Myanmar totally. So what I am trying to tell you is that please don't think that is the gateway at all. I don't think anybody in Delhi, I mean, these young presenters might have given the impression, though I don't think that's what their intention. So please be assured, if anything, that India means extremely well by Myanmar. They want Myanmar to develop so that nobody else can, not only Myanmar, whether it is Sri Lanka, whether it is anybody else, unless they are well developed, strong, we are scared that others will exploit that weakness. To that extent, we want to strengthen every neighbor of ours. Thank you.
Yeah, please.
You know, thanks. Just one, you know, short, very short comment. In terms of Yunnan, the gateway strategy you haven't really mentioned. That was the one area which China's connectivity is with Central Asia, and Yunnan's gateway strategy is what was the mother of what is called maritime strategy, you know, connectivity, maritime Silk Route, as well as the larger, you know, Chinese Silk Route project. And the second issue is that if you observe the things from the Yunnan perspective, from since 2007, they have instituted provincial institutes working with regard to connectivity between Yunnan, Myanmar, and India. And also Yunnan was somehow aggrieved in terms of the development which was seen in Guangzhou and Shanghai provinces. So that really compelled Yunnan to really look forward for South Asia. What I came across in the international conferences organized in Yunnan, they said they don't care about the border dispute between India and China because they just want connectivity to South Asia because that's what matters. Thank you.
I'll give an opportunity to the first the two lady participants to respond. And then maybe if you have time, we can ask some more questions, okay? I would also like my fellow colleague, the other presenter, to also say what he wants to say, if he wants to say anything. Thank you very much.
Yes, sir. The intent of my presentation as citing Myanmar as a gateway should not be viewed as with a narrow perspective, narrow vision as a channel or a corridor, but with a broader vision of rejuvenating the connections, the developments, and in that case, India-Myanmar relations and neighborliness is very much required. That was the motive of my presentation. Not as a channel or a corridor, but as a gateway to development, to more enriching relationship. And regarding your expansion of China's influence, I made a study of the China's reach to the Bay of Bengal region. And regarding the Mitsun Dam project, I intended to say that the dam has been suspended because the economic expansion has been suspended at the cost of, because it was being done at the cost of environment. So that might have a degrading effect on the country, on the entire country. So that was a very bold, very good initiative by Myanmar. Even nowadays, when there is a lot of conversation on climate change, on environment, this step has been taken by Myanmar by overlooking by the impact of the economic impact. It should be appreciated. We do appreciate Sino-Myanmar relations. But there are certain hiccups in the relationship too. We have to admit that. So that was my intention to do. And regarding India-Myanmar relation, as I started my presentation with Pandit Nehru's statement that there are wide horizons of relationship between the two. My presentation should not be misinterpreted like by confining ourselves to gateway thing. That's my submission.
Thank you, sir, for your comments. I am really sorry if it came across that I am worried about Chinese influence in Myanmar. That is not the case. My area of interest is to understand how China is dealing with its neighbor, who India has, in the past, for a long time, not had specific tangible results with over the years, historically. Although we have a lot of cultural linkages that has come out in these 2 days of conference. That was merely what I was trying to do. Also, understanding China's approach provides useful insights into how a neighbor is dealing with Myanmar, which is undergoing a transition in itself. I do not see Myanmar as a gateway, quote unquote, but India needs to engage with the country that's undergoing a transition and whom we have not been interacting with for the nearly 30 years specifically. Only in the recent past that there's been a surge of visits and etc. So in this regard, I think it becomes all the more essential to understand how China is being dealing with the issues that are plaguing Myanmar and not seeing it as a gateway. As far as the second comment, I agree, Yunnan was the benchmark, but later on Guangxi kind of overtook it. But Guangxi came in later. Yunnan actually started the entire process and then Guangxi came in, and then you had the entire Nanning channel towards Vietnam and all of that. So that's a given. But I think in terms of looking at it, Myanmar's perspective, Yunnan played a bigger role. So thank you.
Personally, I don't hate Chinese, but I was born in Mandalay. When we were born in Mandalay, we have the harmony and unity between Chinese community and the Myanmar community. But after 1988, many things changed because Chinese immigrants, sorry to say, they are very unethical. They have easy access to the people in authority, power, by using their illegal money. Also, maybe you know about the fact the land price of Manly is higher than that of price in Manhattan in United States because of their, I don't want to elaborate because this is one thing. Before I came here, I have my immediate, the EDB consultant, Canadian lady. She make a joke. Don't talk about bad things in China and India because they know more than you do. That is my message. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Any other questions? Yeah. Yes, please.
Not so much as a question, but just a very brief comment. It is, what shall we say, the fate of Myanmar to be situated between the two most populous countries in the world, between China and India. And the influence of these both countries have been on our country throughout the years. When I say years, I'm not talking about 10 years or 20 years, I'm talking about hundreds of years, thousands of years. So China and India are both very important for us. And because I don't want to take too much time, I'll be very brief and say very openly, we live with these two giants. We have to know how to live with these two giants. And we have to know, at least we try to know, although I'm not sure that we are always successful, how to get the best from these two giants. Thank you very much.
I think you people are doing extremely well. I think I accept your point. Both countries are big countries. They have powerful influences. I think you're doing a great job of navigating treacherous waters, right? You're doing it extremely well, okay? So I think if there are no more questions, we'll kind of come and come call this session to a halt. Before we do that, I would like to join me in thanking the presenters for, I think it's evoked a lot of controversy. One of the purposes of such conferences is to obviously evoke such controversy, so that many of our actual positions and what we want to say gets clarified, and in the process maybe we get closer to a deeper understanding of the central core issues on which we want to understand and debate and come to some kind of an agreement on. Okay. So having said that, let me ask all of you to join me in thanking the presenters and maybe giving them, for all the work that they have put in, a kind of applause a little bit for what they did. Thank you very much again. I personally enjoyed this because for the first time I think we got a little bit away from diplomacy and the nice things we need to say and get to really talk about things that we should be talking about maybe. Thank you very much for extremely honest and forthright opinions and statements and exchanges. And I think it will help us do things better together. Thank you very much.